Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asks for anything back.
It is a way of life to always honor the environment. It's not something that you just can turn on and off. It's a living daily lifestyle.
A land acknowledgement is a way to acknowledge that we're coexisting in this land with the native people, and we should acknowledge that this is actually their traditional territory. But at the same time, we are all guests to this land.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's program, Fictionalizing History, co-presented by the Calgary Distinguished Writers Program at the University of Calgary and the Calgary Public Library. Tonight's program is a Zoom webinar and is a panel discussion. Zoom is automatically set to gallery view, but you can change it to speaker view if you like. The program will run from 7 to 8 p.m. With questions for 45 minutes from the moderators, and for 15 minutes of questions and answers from the audience. So if you do want to ask a question for one of the panelists, you can leave it in the chat and we will retrieve it from there at the end. Tonight's moderators are Alex Hanley, who is the coordinator of the Calgary Distinguished Writers Program at the University of Calgary, and Rosemary Griebel, Service Design Lead for Readers at the Calgary Public Library.
Thank you so much, Gwen. So as Gwen mentioned, my name is Alex. I'm with the Calgary Distinguished Writers Program, also known as the CDWP. I am so thrilled that we could partner with the Calgary Public Library to bring you this evening's event, which will first, of course, explore the benefits and the perils of melding fact and fiction in writing, and then dive into some Q&A with you, our online audience. So moderating tonight's discussion alongside Rosemary is a great honor, and I'm so pleased to dive right in and introduce you to one of tonight's three panelists, Alberta-based playwright Meg Braem. So Meg is currently Canadian writer in residence with the CDWP, where she offers free manuscript consultations to writers and speaks to groups around the city, all while working on her own writing projects. Her publications include The Josephine Knot and Blood, A Scientific Romance, which has been nominated for the 2020 Governor General's Literary Award in Drama. Her work has been widely presented in Western Canada and has won the Alberta Playwriting Competition twice, as well as the Alberta Literary Award for Drama. Her current work in progress is called The Resurrectionists, and this play is loosely based on a true story about medical students at Queen's University in the 1860s who robbed graves for their own anatomical material, a very intriguing historical subject. So welcome, Meg, and thank you, Rosemary, for having us here from the CDWP.
Thank you. Thank you, Alex. I'm absolutely thrilled to be part of this program. I'm the design lead for reader services at Calgary Public Library. And we actually offer six different types of residencies each year. And tonight we have representatives from two of the residencies. So the Author in Residence program, which has been offered for over 30 years, hosts an established author who connects with authors in the community to review manuscripts and provide workshops on craft. Our 2020 author in residence is Laurie Hahnel. Laurie is very active in the community as an instructor, mentor, and co-founder of Writing in the Works. She is the author of two novels and two short story collections, one which was just launched in October. This collection, called Vermin, is receiving rave reviews and has been on the Calgary and Alberta bestseller lists for weeks. Laurie is currently working on a novel about Clara Schumann, one of the most distinguished pianists of the Romantic era and the wife of composer Robert Schumann. Shaun Hunter is our historian in residence, a program offered in partnership with Heritage Calgary, and it supports researchers working in any genre related to the history of Calgary and the broader Treaty 7 area. Shaun shares her passion for Calgary's literary history through presentations, exhibits, guided walks, and her website. Her book, Calgary Through the Eyes of Writers, takes readers on a literary tour of Calgary from its frontier beginnings to contemporary city. As the 2020 historian in residence, Shaun is mapping Calgary's literary landmarks and will be launching a digital map in January 2021. Welcome, everybody, and I'm now going to hand the discussion back over to Alex to begin our questions.
So our first question tonight is primarily for Lori and Meg. There are so many ways to look at past events and try to make sense of them. So how do you choose the lens through which to view the history that you write about? And Lori, perhaps we can start with you.
Sure. Thank you, Alex. Myself, I have a tendency to want to look at the lesser known side of a story, particularly the distaff side, which is the side that concerns women. Most of the historical figures in my new collection, Vermin, Shaun told me to bring books. My new collection, Vermin, concerned famous historical figures like Chopin and Tom Thompson. But the story that I tell is through the lens of the women in their lives. So generally, I'm also interested in underdogs and the disenfranchised, which, as we know, women have been for most of history. That's my take on it.
Wonderful. And Meg, how about yourself?
Yeah, I think it's similar. I think I look for something that I can relate to. So often it is a woman's story, and thinking of a different perspective of the usual narrative. And that, and then it comes, I think stories to me come through character. So sometimes it isn't. Sometimes I wrote a play about a 100-year-old man who that character is very far from me. But it became about, so I don't know if there's a logic, but how does the character pop up in my head?
Mm-hmm. Fascinating, thank you.
And Shaun, what about you? I know you, of course, focused on Calgary. What are some of the lenses through which writers have talked about Calgary?
Okay, well, I brought some show and tell. I wanted to talk to you first about John Ballam, who was an oil patch lawyer in Calgary and a novelist. And he was very interested in capturing the city's oil industry in fiction. And his lens was through a suspense thriller kind of thing. Lots of material there, men, money, power. And those stories are extremely, I haven't read them all, violent. A lot of violence in those stories. So that's kind of interesting. I wanted to talk about this one, Marina Endicott's The Little Shadows, which is a really lovely book about the vaudeville era in prairie cities, including Calgary. She stumbled upon this history in the Glenbow Archives. She was doing something completely unrelated and saw all these photographs of young women vaudeville actors, players. And so hers is through an urban female lens of that 1910s period. And then this one is really a classic Calgary historical novel by Catherine Govier, Between Men. And she's looking at 1889 Calgary, a couple of storylines in this novel. But what's wonderful is we see the narrator is a female historian. And we see her early in the book, in the moment, in the archive, in the moment of figuring out which lens she's going to use to tell the story of a real life murder of a Cree girl in 1889 Calgary. So really interesting book. So they're just three examples of different lenses through which writers have looked at Calgary's history.
That's so interesting. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Wow, yes, that vaudeville history. I'm so curious to learn more about that. So this question builds off that a little bit, and it's for each of you, but do you have a favorite time period or historical era that you gravitate toward? And Shaun, maybe we can start with you. I'm curious in your research and in your work.
Yeah, well, I'm not a writer of fiction, but my current area of research that I've just really I'm very excited about is the interwar period in Calgary. A quiet period historically, before the great post-war oil boom. After the First World War, of course, just a period in the city's life where it was sort of like between, it was called the City of the Foothills back then. It was before the Stampede brand, pardon the pun, really took hold. It was before Leduc in 1947, so before the post-war oil industry heated up. And so the city was kind of free of those prevailing narratives. What I've discovered in my research in the last couple of years is that there was a very vibrant literary community starting in the early 1920s in Calgary. And to me, that's just fascinating. I've dug up all of these different personalities. Gosh, I must have two dozen writers, each coming to the story with their own really interesting life stories. So I'm really fascinated in that period. I'm going to be doing a little more research and writing about that.
And if I can ask you, Shaun, this is a bit of a diversion, I guess, but to what degree did the Depression then affect the literary community at that time?
Yeah, I've been sort of focusing on the 20s, Rosemary, right now, but there's I have done a little of digging into the 30s. It continued to be a factor in the cultural scene, the literary scene. It didn't just go dormant in the 30s, but there's more to discover there, yes. Mm.
That's interesting. Mm,
and now we have two writers from our contemporary Calgary writing community here with us. And Lori, what time eras fascinate you? And is there a particular place in the world that fascinates you as well?
You know, I have written a lot about Calgary, although I don't know if I've really written about Calgary's history in my fiction. But I find that the more I write historical fiction, the further back I want to go. So my first novel, Love Minus Zero, is loosely based on my experience in a first wave punk band in Calgary in the late 70s and early 80s. And when I did a reading from it at Memorial Park Library when it came out, I was introduced as a writer of historical fiction. So, so arguably I have been writing historical fiction all along. My second novel was partly based in the 1930s and the 1980s, so I was going a little further back with that one. And now I'm working on my novel about Clara Schumann, who lived from 1819 to 1896. So I feel like if I keep writing fiction, I'll probably just keep going back in time and see where I land up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and go ahead, Rosemary.
I just want to ask Lori, do you find it easier to be writing about Clara Schumann as compared to the punk band or punk era when all of us would remember that era? Is one easier than the other, or are they just different?
You know, they're just different. And actually, I really find in Clara's story that there is some similarity. I mean, women in Clara's day, I feel like were sort of disenfranchised from the music scene, as they were in the punk era. So, you know, the more I look at her time, the more I see parallels between her time and, well, not our time, I guess, but 30 years ago, 40 years ago, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Wow, that's so interesting. I don't know a lot about the punk scene in Calgary, so that's something that I want to learn more about as well. And Meg,
there's a book you can read.
There is a book.
Tell me, Shaun. Which
there
one?
It is, Lori. There it is. The book.
I'll have to grab it from Lori after this Zoom.
Awesome.
And Meg, your work, The Resurrectionist, that you're working on now, is late 19th century. Is that correct? Late 1800s. Mm-hmm. And what does that period hold for you in terms of interest?
I think for me specifically, it was about that situation. It was the clash of like women not being able to go to medical school, as well as like medical. I just can't imagine this. I just can't believe that doctors were tasked with finding, like, that was their homework. You need to learn anatomy, find a body. And I have somebody's dissertation on it. And I've read it a couple of times and I'm like, well, where's the logic part of that? But that's for that specific play. As far as having a favorite time, I was thinking about it when you were talking and I'm like, I just wrote a play that was in ancient Greece and where I got to reread all the Greek tragedies, which I love so dearly. And then a play that, because of this position, I think like, hopefully I'll have time to dig back into, is a play set in Alberta, fiction, but during the Depression, in which good old Pierre Burton becomes very helpful. And the winter years or 10 lost years.
Yeah.
I can't remember. It's on my bookshelf.
James H. Gray.
And Barry Bradford. Yeah.
So I don't think I have a favorite, but it's like what lends to that story.
Right. And where did the inspiration for the Resurrectionists come from? Do you pick things up as you read or as you watch film, or where does that inspiration come from?
I went to a conference to watch my husband give a paper. My husband's a historian. And it was a history of medicine conference. And it was largely like really boring. But then somebody came up and they were, and that's what they started to talk about. And then I found out this student had written his master's dissertation on this history and he was doing his master's degree at Queen's. And then luckily enough, he then moved to Calgary to be a med student. So I sort of fangirled him and got his work.
It's interesting what sort of inspires a writer. So Laurie, if I can just to build on what Meg talked about, why Clara Schumann?
Mm-hmm. Why Clara Schumann?
Like, what was it about it that?
You know, it was a gradual kind of fascination that grew for me with her. I watched a movie about her called Song of Love, and Katharine Hepburn was playing her. And I mean, you know what Katharine Hepburn is like. She kind of plays herself in whatever movie she's in. And I thought, you know, I doubt that this woman was really much like Katharine Hepburn. So I did some reading. And the more I found out about her very interesting life, you know, the more I felt like I wanted to find some of this story that I could glom onto and go with and make into a novel.
Cool. And so do you think we have certain obligations as writers to the historical figures that we write about? What obligations, if any? And I'll ask both you and Meg that question.
Do you want me to start out?
Sure.
This is a question that I've been struggling with while I've been writing about Clara Schumann. One of the things that did attract me to her story is the love triangle that seems to have existed between her and her husband, Robert Schumann, and Johannes Brahms, and the persistent rumor that Brahms fathered the Schumann's last child, Felix, who happened to bear a striking resemblance to Brahms. Of course, it's a long and complicated story with Schumann dying at age 46 after living in an asylum for 2 years. The Schumann family always took great pains to uphold Clara's idealized image as a faithful wife, but the facts are somewhat less black and white. So as an author, for me, someone who's writing a fictionalized account of her story, do I go with rumors and just invent and embellish, or do I pull back and stick with what is definitively known? And I'm at the end of a first draft right now. In the new year, I hope to get into the second draft, and I hope to refine some of these issues as I go along. I'm really not sure what the answer to those questions are. And as a matter of fact, Here we go. I've developed a second contemporary character she's a filmmaker and she's making a film about Clara, and she is exploring those questions. So I hope that in the course of writing about this character, maybe I'll figure it out or not.
Yeah. And you're hoping to go to Germany as well and do additional research.
Yeah, I was supposed to go in May, but then, you know, the pandemic happened. So as it stands right now, I'm hoping to go next year. We'll see. Fingers crossed.
Great. And Meg, what would you say in terms of what obligations writers have to historical figures?
I think I don't know if there's a particularly right answer. I think you have to you kind of have to be inspired, and you kind of have, I mean, working with history can be both freeing and limiting, and then it becomes a thing of, I've seen writers before become trapped by the truth, and then they become kind of paralyzed by it, and they're very nervous, and so they feel like they can't create their story. So for me, I don't generally use a particular person, or I haven't so far, but I use a particular timeline, but even that has a modern bent. So looking at, I just wrote a Greek tragedy. It is in contemporary language, because if you look at the Greek tragedies, there, it's all 3-page long speeches. Audiences can't stomach it anymore. And so it becomes like, the situations are amazing. It's the language that we can't handle. So even right now, when I started writing the Resurrectionist, I was reading Dickens to try and get a feel for that language. And then I wrote my first draft and somebody was like, it doesn't read as authentic, which maybe is just like a comment on my writing, but I like to believe it was too much. So I think you kind of can go too far and then you can go back. And so I will always have a contemporary lens on history. And I feel like that'll be the bridge of my work to the history.
Mm-hmm. And can I just say that when you're writing fiction, I mean, we talk, when you're writing creative nonfiction, you can basically do anything as long as you're upfront with the reader about what you're doing, right? But with fiction, we all know when we step into a novel as a reader, if we're reading a story or if we're reading a history. And I have different expectations as a reader of fiction than I do of a history text. So I think you've got a lot of room to play with. You know, I know in a couple of Calgary historical novels, the date of the opening of the Palliser Hotel is wrong, right? And it irks a little. And then you think, well, it doesn't fit the story, so whatever, right? This is a story. I have to, if I want fact, I'm going to go somewhere else. So I think you have a lot of latitude.
That's right. And I mean, that's, I think, how I have, the problem I'm struggling with, that's how I have to look at it in the end, is that I'm telling a story. I'm not writing a book of history. So, you know, maybe that's the bottom line.
It is interesting how heated it can get. Like now that the most recent season of The Crown has just dropped on Netflix, everything on my algorithm is, was that true to Diana? Wasn't that true to Diana? Diana's brother is going to weigh in. Someone else is going to weigh in. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like I never expected this to be such a hot topic.
Right.
Meg, do you think that there's some call that they should have some disclaimer, like in, you know, front of novels saying if this looks like a real character, it's just a coincidence. Should they've had a disclaimer on The Crown? Or is it not obvious that this is a story?
I don't think so. I think, well, I mean, like, I don't know. We believe they are fiction to us anyway. Like everything we read is mostly maybe not true, but we feel like we know them. So that becomes a sense of ownership. And it, like watching the beginning episodes of that, I was like, I don't know the history. So I believe, yeah, it's kind of easy to believe everything. And then they could say it's a coincidence, but also like, didn't we nail Diana's haircut?
Yeah.
I know for me, when I was watching The Crown, I had, you know, the one screen with the show and then the other screen with my phone where I'm doing my research.
Nice.
And I'm curious to know, like, does the act of researching ever get in the way of your writing or vice versa? And how do you handle that search for facts and also that play, that more creative side, when you're working on your writing?
For me, the research part always threatens to, you know, stop me from writing. And I think especially when you're writing historical fiction, the temptation to just do a little more research is always there. And sometimes once you get started, it's really hard to get off the hamster wheel of research. Mm-hmm. You know, I have found that sometimes I have to just make myself commit to just working on the writing itself. And if there's something that I don't know, or if I need to look it up later, I have to type in, you know, XXX or some question marks and come back to it later. Otherwise, I will go and look it up and waste, you know, hours of time. And yeah, it's a toughie. I struggle with it all the time.
I feel like it's the most fun.
It's the most fun writing.
It's so nice to lie down and like read all your all the information, but also to be like, I'm working, so it's cool. I don't feel limited. Like I think I spend 50% of my time researching and then I start working. I also think the truth or the things you find in history books, there's always something better than you could have ever made up. Yeah. And so, before I researched, I remember like the first time going into the library and digging through things and being like, this is so great. I don't have to make up stuff anymore. Yeah. I can thread things together, but it's nice to have those touchstones.
Yes.
And the thing is, if you stop too soon, you know there's other really good stuff out there that you haven't found.
Maybe it's the best stuff, Shaun.
It could be the best stuff. That's like old newspapers. I'm gonna answer that question a little bit differently. And maybe this is because I'm not a fiction writer, but where I have gotten bogged down with research is because I didn't leave a really good trail for myself. So I'm gulping it all down, and I'm throwing stuff here and making, but then I go back and I think, weeks later, I read that. Where did I put it? Mm-hmm. And that is so frustrating. I hate that. So I have just trial and error. I've had to come up with a system for organizing my research so that I can find the stuff. I have been very sloppy with citations in the past. I am a citation woman. Like, and it's lovely, this newspaper service that I'm happily using because Heritage Calgary gave me let me use their account, has a really nice, every time you take a PDF clipping, it actually builds the date from the newspaper into the file name.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So, if my filing system breaks down, I can still search a date and I can find the thing. But I think that's really, it's an important, it's been really important to me. The other thing I found very, very useful is to create a timeline.
Yes.
And that's just so obvious. I know it's painfully, I don't know how I discovered I had to do that, but, and you just throw stuff in there. And it's a great resource for, okay, 1921. All this stuff I know, and I have that, so those are just two little things. If I don't have that stuff under control, it can really affect my confidence as a writer.
Hmm. Zori and Meg, do you find that too, that you have some kind of system to keep track of all the sources you've read, you've researched?
Mine is a lot less formalized than Shaun's. I think I just have a yellow pad that I keep, a list of things on, and it's pretty cumbersome, but it seems to work.
Yeah, as long as it works, right?
Yeah.
I kind of, I keep those books on my desk for the whole writing period. I kind of
awesome.
Obsessed with it. Like even if there's a tiny bit and I get it out of the library, I'm like, I just have to have the book. And then I'll
get mine.
And I'll be like, but this is, I don't know. It's like, it's about confidence, but this is the book where the fact that launched the scene, that launched the character. And then I'll like maybe even never open it again, but I have the book. Like it becomes a bit of an altar or something to that project. A
security blanket.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I'm curious, just in your research, I guess specifically for Lori and Meg, when you're building a world or when you're building that time for the reader, do you ever find yourself researching music or art or aspects of what it was like to live during that time? Do you ever kind of veer off on a tangent away from the facts of perhaps the narrative itself, but in order to build that environment?
I always do that. And I mean, talk about going off on a tangent. Oh, absolutely. But I think, it's essential, like you say, when you're building a world, you're not just talking about the people involved or the events involved, you're talking about the time. And in order to evoke the time, you know, in a rich and engaging way for the reader, you've got to know what did people's hair look like? What were they wearing? What kind of stuff were they eating? You know, what music were they listening to? All that stuff. It's all important. And that's why it takes years and years and years to write a historical novel, right? Because you have to know everything about the period, pretty much.
I don't know. I think I do it maybe differently because I write plays. So I feel like I look for voices, and I look for, like, I think about right now writing The Resurrectionist, one of the most, for a specific part in the play, one of the most helpful books I read was The Five, about the Jack the Ripper, the women that Jack the Ripper and it's about profiling those women. Their narratives really, really brought home for me, oh, a woman really was as good as the men she was connected to. And that, even though this story takes place in Canada and it's not violent, but I'm like, it really solidified that. So I sometimes think it's about a theme or a kernel in society that I look for.
I wonder, Meg, too, if, because you're writing a play, it's a little bit different in that you don't necessarily have to build in all that sensory detail into what you're writing.
No, right? If I do, they'll ignore me.
Exactly. But you know what I'm saying? Mostly you're writing dialogue when you're writing.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. So. And I think, like, when people ask me about that kind of, like, design, I see it like it's real in my head, or I see it like it's actors in blacks in a black studio, and I never can see the design stuff. So I feel, and I think because I've been doing it so long now, it's just, I know that I'm building the foundation for other people's creativity. Right. So I don't have their skills, and I don't step on their toes.
It's not your job to have those skills though. So
yeah. Right? And I really don't
have them. So pure. It sounds so pure.
No, nothing's more pure than a good novel.
Well,
I don't know, character in a black room.
Yeah, that sounds pretty pure to me.
Yeah, it also, I don't know what to say.
So what would you say are the sort of the main benefits and perils of writing fictionalized history?
I think Meg touched on this a little bit before, but for me, the benefit of writing historical fiction is, besides the fact that I love history, that there is a certain amount of the story already there in a historical figure or event, and you get to embellish it or tell the story in the way that you want to tell it. Did you already say about the perils, Rosemary?
Yeah, well.
Should I just go on with that?
Sure.
Okay. Well, the perils, of course, and we've talked about this already, but just to reiterate, getting stuck on the research wheel, which is always a problem for me, trying to decide which part of the story you want to tell when it comes to a person's life. You know, when I started looking at Clara Schumann, at first I was just focused on the love triangle, but then the more I read, the more I found out interesting things about her entire life. So then I thought, well, am I writing a story about her from the moment she was born until the moment she dies? I don't think so. So you have to, you know, decide what part of the story you want to focus on. And then you have to decide which part of their story you should tell. I mean, there's a lot of questions. So those are some of the perils. Maybe I'll hand it over to Meg.
I think the perils of, when we did our prep, we were kind of talking about the idea of what is history, and then it becomes what is the truth.
Yeah.
So, you know, thinking about even wars, like, you know, if you think of Vimy, and some people think it's like the nation building moment, but then other people think it was divisive and controversial. So that's two completely different versions of history. And I was saying to Shaun that I didn't really know that for a long, long time. I didn't know about historiography. I thought that I didn't know that their history, the history we're telling now, will maybe change later based on our lens. So that can be an interesting thing. One book that I read that touches on that kind of, it's dealing with war history. Guys, that was so awkward. But anyway. Is death so noble? And this is about commemoration and sort of the narratives we tell with the way that we remember wars. And so that could be the same thing with anything, or what narrative are we weaving through the way we remember things? So that's sort of the perils and the good things about it. And then, like I said earlier, I think, you know, and it happens in any history or any past, even personal pasts, when people use those of jumping off points, they can be so earnest about telling the truth and telling every detail that they can't launch and they can't free themselves into creativity. So I think those are some of the perils. And then again, the fact that you find amazing, delicious nuggets that you could never make up. Yeah. That's the best part.
And they're better than anything you could make up, right?
They're so good, yeah.
Sometimes are they so good that if you put them in the story, people will not believe it.
Yeah.
Is there that danger? Yeah.
Well, and I think you've touched on something interesting in that it's that idea of choice, of choosing. There are so many perspectives and often they're conflicting and having to decide. And Shaun, your work, Calgary Through the Eyes of Writers, examines how novels and stories and poems have captured this city over time. So I'm curious, how have writers cracked Calgary's history open to explore different and contradicting perspectives?
Okay, well, I went whipping through my bookshelves. I had so much fun. I want to talk about this book, Barb Howard's Whipstock. And it's not a historical novel, it's a contemporary novel, but she channels a historical character. And this is a really wild ride. You know, it starts off in the early pages of the book, a woman is impregnated by an oil derrick. So after that, anything is possible, right? So what she does is she channels, so Barb is really looking at the oil patch through a female perspective. She's really countering that world that John Ballam, evokes in his oil patch novels. But this is from a female perspective, three generations. And the historical character is the dead grandmother who was a doodlebug, an early geophysicist type, I believe. And she is channeled through the protagonist's computer. She speaks to the narrator through the computer. So it's really quite clever and unorthodox in every single respect. This one, Nancy Houston's Plain Song. Again, a fiction, very subject, a historic, it's a granddaughter looking back at her prairie grandfather's life and his unhappiness. It's a very angry book. It's got some stream of consciousness. It's got some very lyrical passages, a lot of emotion. This is not the woman telling the story is not looking for objectivity and historical fact. She is looking for a very, it's a very personal book. It's also trying to disrupt this prevailing narrative of progress that we have in the Canadian West. She's cracking that open every single page. It's really quite interesting. Yeah. So those are two. And then I just thought I'd bring along, you know, this book, a historical novel about the punk rock scene in Calgary. So I have three books just from the 80s. So the 80s were a really interesting time in Calgary. We just come off this manic period of boom. And then of course the National Energy Program, boom, everything stops, 1980. And so I've got three historical novels I want, and I am going to call that a historical novel.
I guess it is now.
Sorry.
next on my list.
three Calgary novels that are exploring that early 80s period, which is this kind of moment, a special kind of moment. So we get the punk rock scene in this book. Nancy Jo Cullen's book, The Western Alienation Merit Badge, is a queer coming of age story set in 1981 Calgary. Not at all a story that you would associate with Calgary, really. And then this 1990s novel by Norman Raven, again, looking at the early 80s in Calgary, telling the story of three generations of a Jewish family. So not the story you would expect to hear about Calgary. So those are just three examples from that period. And I think fiction writers, I turn to fiction writers to tell those unexpected, unknown, surprising stories about the city's history. Literary writers are not looking for, they're looking to crack open the stereotypes. They're looking to get underneath the mythologies. I think it's a wonderful service you're doing writing historical fiction. Thank you.
There's a number of questions coming in on chat, so we want to get to those, but maybe we can, the question I think for everybody, and you've already kind of touched on it, and it's something that Mary Carr, I was just listening to a podcast with her, talks about how everybody has their own lens when they look at history. So in fact, is all history fiction?
I think so. I think that all history is like historical fiction. So it's a narrative, if you will, that contains a certain amount of facts and a certain amount of the teller's lens or the teller's point of view. I mean, like Meg was saying earlier, I think at some point in my life, I kind of thought that history was just, you know, like sanitized facts, but it's not the case. I mean, there's always a perspective from the teller. So that's what I think.
And I mean, when you talked about Vimy Ridge, that really brought it home, but do you want to just elaborate on that?
Oh, Shaun, I feel like you should elaborate for me.
No way. I have nothing to say about Vimy Ridge.
Oh. I just remember when I thought it was like, when it was the 100-year anniversary, and then there was all this stuff on the news about this was a nation-building moment. And then my husband was like, read this book. And I was just like, oh, I don't know. Do I want it? Like, I like those fuzzy moments. And then going, oh, no, everything's more complicated than you think. And I just think it's interesting to think of narratives and also what we use them for. So for me, and maybe Laura, you talked about looking at things through a female lens. I have an agenda, whether or not I want to admit it, in my writing, which is really to have a female voice in those stories. And so that always is going to shape the way that I look at those histories. I'm going to be speaking through characters that are women usually in those situations. And so, I do think all history is fiction. And yeah.
And but don't Shaun, you think-
I want to hear a historian talk about it.
I'm not, oh yeah. Except not, yeah, okay. Go ahead, Laura, you were going to say something.
I was just going to say, don't you think, Meg, that it's so normal and natural for us as women to be writing from the point of view of women? Just a little while ago, someone was asking me, an interviewer was asking me, why did I write about women so much in my latest collection? And I'm like, well, because I'm a woman, you know, like, why wouldn't I? I mean, if you turn it around, why wouldn't I? Why would I write about men? So yeah, I feel like I have that agenda too, if you want to put it that way. I think being a woman, you can't really help having it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So we have a number of audience questions, like Rosemary mentioned, and I think this one builds off what we were just talking about, so I'd like to ask it first. But in terms of having that agenda, picking a perspective, the question is, how do you best keep your work contemporary or relevant to the present when writing historical fiction?
So
does it come down to picking that agenda and that lens?
I think the best way to talk about the present is through historical fiction or just through history. There's a great book called The Art of War. Anyway, not thinking about the famous one, but it was a guy who would go into military bases and he would read, he would do readings of Greek tragedies. And so he did it once and he thought that it would just be kind of an interesting thing, but it became an amazing way for soldiers who had just gotten back from Afghanistan to talk about all of the trauma that they'd faced through these Greek tragic plays. It gave enough distance that they could talk about what they were going through in a safe way. And I think that is one of the great things about historical fiction and looking at history, is that, you know, we can talk about it. Things really haven't changed. History repeats itself.
Yeah, I agree. I think that the historical figures that I have had a chance to look at all have kind of some of the same issues that contemporary people have. I mean, people are dealing with the same basic issues a lot of the time. Clara Schumann, for instance, was someone who struggled to find work-life balance, which probably wasn't even an expression in her time, but she really was going through that experience as a widowed mother, a widowed mother of eight children. She had very little time to do work. And I think a lot of contemporary women can relate to that kind of thing. So I think the experiences of the people that we write about are really the bridge to our contemporary readers.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
It's interesting. Shaun, somebody was wondering what the last book was that you held up.
This is Cafe de Westons by Norman Raven.
And Aretha Van Herk asked if there is a Calgary story that hasn't been told but needs to be told.
That needs to be told.
Oh.
Well, I made a little list of, I'm not sure, Aretha, I want to answer the needs part, because, you know, I'm just going to be a historian and stand in the back and, you know, let others decide what's needed. I've never seen the fire of 1886. There was a very seminal historical event. It turned our city into the Sandstone City. I've never seen that in a novel. Again, I think the interwar period has not really been explored a lot. There are some. I haven't seen the 1960s in a lot of Calgary fiction, which is interesting. And I'm not even sure I think we're still waiting for the Stampede novel. Isn't that a weird thing to say?
There's not a Stampede novel.
Well, is there?
I don't know.
Stampede is in lots of places. It's in novels, but is there a? I've not read it.
I don't think so.
Yeah. So, and it's interesting how we're seeing the 2013 flood. Certainly, writers were writing about that, of course, journalists, and there's a Lee Caverne story set during that time. And just this fall, two flood novels have come out, Robin Van Eck's Rough and Alexandra Latt's Under Shifting Stars, a YA book. So I think we're going to see more of the flood. Let's see. But yeah, those are just the gaps I'm seeing. Again, the 30s, a little bit, glimpses here and there, but and you know, who knows, maybe the 2020s are going to be the time when we really need to understand the 1930s.
Here's a question
that way.
Just jumping off of that, do you think, or how long do you think, or do you think that there needs to be a time between a historical event and our ability to consume literature or historical books about it?
You know, I remember this line. It was in, I think, a Eleanor Wachtel program years and years ago, and she was interviewing the German artist. I think his name is Anselm Kiefer, and he was talking about 100 years. Mm-hmm. It's sort of magical, mm-hmm. where you actually have the perspective to look back. And I'm personally finding that, I think that's part of my interest in the 1920s, is we have 100 years we can see. It's also, for me, a highly relatable decade. But I think there's something about a century. I don't know. What do you think?
I was just going to say that W.O. Mitchell said, when you're writing about personal events that happen in your own life, he suggested that about 10 years would be the minimum that you would want to wait. So, I mean, in a life, 10 years is a fair span, but he thought that the experience would have time to compost in your mind and meld with other experience. So I think that's, you know, that's good advice.
Mm-hmm. There have been, I remember watching a play about, it was Sharon Pollock's play about the flood. Yes. And it seemed very soon after. And I remember sitting in the theater and I was like, oh, I don't know if I'm ready. I don't know if I'm ready for it.
When do you think we're gonna see COVID-19 in fiction?
I wonder if we're going to see it at all. Because when you think about it, look at the Spanish flu. How much literature? There. There's none of it, because I think when it's over, people just want to move on, be done with it. So
it is in a 1923 Calgary novel, the Spanish flu epidemic in Winifred.
Oh, okay. Cattle. Okay.
It's the only one I found.
It's in a really famous Canadian play called Unity 1918, but that's only about 10 years old by Stephen Kevin Kerr. Yeah. Kevin Kerr.
So 10 years old. So that's interesting.
Yeah. And again, about 100 years gap.
But it's interesting because I was thinking about that. I'm like, oh, wow, everything is happening. And I'm like, I don't think any theaters are going to be producing it anytime soon.
No, because do you want to, that's not what I want to read right now.
Guys, how I picked this up and I could not get through half of it because I was like, I know it already. I know it.
Is it Peeps? I don't even know who's the author.
William Defoe.
Oh, okay. Mm. Okay.
And it's not his personal experience, but he got, he researched it. And then, so it's written like it's true, but it is fiction. It's a fictionalized character going through it.
So with all these books behind all of you, we have a question from Donna, and she's wondering, Donna Crawford, wondering, what are some of your favorite works of historical fiction? And Shaun, you held up some great examples. Curious to hear from Lori, Meg, and Shaun, if you have any more as well.
Well, I have three of my favorites right here with me. One of them is Tracy Chevalier's Girl with a Pearl Earring. I think this is one of the best historical novels I've ever read. It's beautifully written. The next one, this is also really beautifully written, The Dream Lover by Elizabeth Berg. And the cover art is hideous. It doesn't tell you what it's about at all. It's written, it's about Chopin's lover, George Sand. Oh. And it's a fascinating novel, but the cover art is very bad. And the final one is Girl Runner by Canadian writer Carrie Snyder. And it is about Agonitha Smart, who was a gold medalist runner in the 1928 Olympics. Oh, wow. Just beautifully written, and a story that I knew nothing about until I was given this book as a gift. So Girl Runner by Carrie Snyder, fascinating. Those are mine.
We're gonna have to send out a reading list.
Yeah. Another question. How do you deal with this?
Is Meg gonna tell us one of her favorites?
Yeah, sorry.
No, I don't know. I don't know if it's my favorite, but it was probably my most recent page turner read. Also, I feel like embarrassed about how shiny these books are. I inherited them. They just The Jungle. Which I started reading because of all the outbreaks happening in meatpacking places.
Yeah,
yeah. And this book blew my mind. So that's the most recent one.
And I want to show one non-Calgary novel if I could. I know it's out of my bailiwick, but the Wolf Hall trilogy is. I'm not really a historical fiction reader until this Calgary project, but. This is genre busting. This thing is, it's so completely immersive.
It has, I think, the best opening chapter of any book I've ever read. I was just riveted to that opening chapter. Amazing.
Meg, somebody just asked, what was the name of the book that you referred to about reading Greek plays to Afghan soldiers?
Oh, I gotta look, I'm gonna Google it. I can't remember what it's called. It's amazing. Ugh. Okay, don't mind me, sorry.
We'll let Meg Google it.
This is so embarrassing.
Maybe we'll ask another question then while Meg's looking that up, because there's quite a few that have come in. How do you deal with specific language of a particular time that is no longer considered appropriate? For example, words that were used to label particular racial, ethnic, or religious groups.
That's interesting you should bring that up, because I am reading for the first time, kind of the first time, I started it before and I'm starting it again, a novel called Look Homeward, Angel by Thomas Wolfe. And he uses so much language and names and, you know, racist terms that we would not use today. And I found it to be just jarring and shocking every time I came across one of these, because it's something we just don't do. So, you know, I've been fortunate, I guess, in what I'm writing that generally it hasn't come up. It's kind of a cop-out answer, but yeah, I was shocked to read those things. I really was.
She's still looking.
I believe it's called The Theater of War.
Theater of War, okay. Awesome. Thank you, Meg.
Oh yeah, Theater of War, What Ancient Tragedies Can Teach Us Today by Brian Dorries, Dorries.
Perfect. So another question here, we had previously asked you all if all history is fiction, and this audience member would like to know, is all fiction then not history? When we think about futuristic novels or futuristic works, are there elements that we're drawing from the past about, and can we ever avoid not looking back and also looking forward, to sort of elaborate on that topic a little bit? Mm. It's a juicy question.
It is. Yeah. Blew our minds. I think writing historical fiction and then writing fantasy is kind of the same thing. I'm not a huge sci-fi reader, but I've had the honor of reading people's fantasy as they're writing it. And you're building a world and you're building narratives within a world. And when I talked, at first I was really nervous about it. I'm like, oh, it isn't that different than me writing about grave robbers. Somebody writing about like a chase with a creature that's not quite a human. I don't think it's that different.
And again, going back to what we were talking about before, I think so many of the experiences of, you know, human life remain the same, whether you're talking about people 500 years ago or people 500 years in the future. I'm sure, you know, many of the issues that we are facing are going to be similar. So, you know, maybe that's another way of looking at it.
Right. Finding those echoes through history.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
To me, again, to turn it around a little bit, for me, fiction has been an invitation into history. I don't think I would have gone into, I don't think I would have been interested in Calgary's history if I hadn't first been invited by novelists. And then I have pursued my own interest and curiosity after that. But for me, yeah, the novel is not history, but it is history. So.
Those were wonderful answers. Thank you.
Maybe there's so many, there's really good questions. Maybe we'll end with this one. How do you best keep your work contemporary or relevant to the present when writing historical fiction?
One approach I've taken, and I don't really even think this has been a conscious choice with me, but I notice now that I have done it in all the novels I've written, is that I tend to have two time frames. So whether it's a contemporary character looking at a historical character, like in my new novel about Clara Schumann, or whether it's a single character looking at, you know, herself in the 1980s and herself in the 2010s, I always tend to have these dual time frames. And I think that's partly to keep the contemporary lens of it relevant for myself as a writer, as well as for the reader. That's been my approach to it.
Meg, do you have any thoughts?
We can't hear you, Meg.
We've lost Meg. Well, perhaps we can ask one more question and give Meg a chance to get her sound back. Let's see, there were so many here. There is a person who's writing a story, who would like to tell a story that is family related. So they have a lot of details. Some parts their father has written, there are many possible characters. Is it historical fiction if, as the writer, you don't know some of the details of what was thought or said? So maybe you don't have all of the facts, but you're trying to put the narrative together. So this is a bit of a personal question. Yeah, Lori.
I think so, absolutely. I mean, I don't think anybody who's writing any historical fiction manuscript has all the facts. And I mean, the very fact that you're writing a novel means that you're making up at least a certain amount of it. So yeah, I think you absolutely can categorize it as historical fiction.
Right.
Or if you go the other way, you can call it creative nonfiction.
Uh-huh. That's true.
Just
right.
Keep
right.
your options open.
Tomato, tomato, right? Yeah.
I noticed it's just after 8 and I want to respect everybody's time. So I think we'll wrap up. This event will be on the Calgary Public Library YouTube channel. So for anybody who wants to go back and review it or get titles or share it, please do. I really want to thank Alex, first of all, for bringing this idea forward that we come together as a group and talk about fictionalizing history. And I also want to thank the panelists, Meg, Lori, and Shaun, for a really wonderful discussion. Also Guinevere, who helped support this event, and Zaritza, and all the participants. There's many, many of you, and you've asked really good questions. So thank you, everybody. Keep reading, keep writing, and hopefully we'll see you online again soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Good night. Thanks.
Good night. Bye.